Hey, how's it going? Last week we did Charmander, and it was definitely better than Growlithe in every facet of the game. This week, it's time for a more challenging solo run, and from the title, you already know it's Rhyhorn. And I'm gonna keep the intro short, but let's quickly go over the problematic things that Rhyhorn brings to the proverbial table. First, it's in the slow leveling group, and Pokemon that struggle on Brock are always a slog when levels come slow at the start of the game. Second is that its level up move pool is very poor, and that's putting it lightly. It's all normal moves, and it doesn't even learn another move period until level 30, and even then it's just stomp. Third is that its special stat and speed stat are abysmal. Outside of Slowpoke, there aren't many Pokemon slower than this little rhino boy. Lastly, it's times 4 weak to both water and grass, which are fairly common types in general, but they also make up 2 of the first 4 gyms on a standard route. It's also weak to ice, which will more than likely make Lorelei a huge problem, but we'll have to see about that. So besides all that, Rhyhorn is looking pretty good, right? It's not all bad though, and we are all about some positivity on this channel, so let's take a look at some positives hidden in this slow and weak rhino. The TM moveset is actually pretty solid, and it has pretty solid stats in HP, attack, and defense. It also resists normal moves, and that's a plus for a pretty huge chunk of the game. There's lots of normal moves. If you are interested in the rules for these solo runs that I do, I have pasted them in the description, so scroll down if you want to see what we're dealing with. But before we begin, I would like to quickly say that if you enjoy this content, feel free to subscribe and hit that bell to be notified when I drop a video. Most importantly, leaving a like, even a dislike, or a comment of any kind helps out the small channels the most. So if you are a returning viewer or even a new one, feel free to discuss the run, give me some criticism, or even suggest a future run. If you don't have anything to say and you normally don't even bother to comment, just scroll down, type in rock solid, and help get this algorithm going so we can help suggest this video to other people, and maybe I won't be stuck at 100 views for the rest of my entire life. With all that said, let's have some fun with this run and see how it goes. Like always, I reset for decent DVs. We want the best Rhyhorn we can possibly get, and I already don't have faith in this big boy. I name it Spike because I'm a 90s kid, and I cry when I watch The Land Before Time. Go ahead and leave a RIP Littlefoot's mom in the comment section if seeing cartoon dinosaurs' mothers dying is sad to you. From there, I battle all the trainers that I can. The slow leveling group isn't great, and this run is actually very similar to Growlithe, believe it or not. While different types, the first part of the game is going to be very similar, but I'm going to go ahead and call it here. I'm going to say that Rhyhorn will be better than Growlithe. I do backtrack to face the optional rival fight, and here you can get a first glimpse of some of the struggles. Although Bubble is among the weakest moves in the entire game, look at how much damage it does to Rhyhorn. It's actually pathetic how strong it is against us. I try again and I get past it, but that's just because the AI is stupid and uses Tail Whip way too many times, and I survive at the brink of death to move on from this fight. Now after some minor grinding, I go ahead and battle the junior trainer before Brock. I resist all of its Pokemon's moves, and it's a pretty good source of experience. He does his best to make my life miserable by doing some sand attacks, but it goes pretty quick, it's fairly smooth. And then I go ahead and I give Brock an attempt. There's a lot of positives to this fight, like the fact that we resist tackle from both of his Pokemon. Rhyhorn's defense also means that we take even less from them. The problem here is that we only have Horn Attack, and on the Onix I have no choice but to take the full brunt of his bites. And now if you combine that with the odd screech here and there, and then eventually we'll get to struggle strategies, and then you just have a very rough fight that's not possible. I keep grinding up, and I try Brock at various levels to no avail, and at that point, I'm fully prepared to have to get to about level 16 or higher, but I give him another attempt after killing all the Metapods in Viridian, and I get to level 14, and I actually make it past. As you can see, Geodude is extremely easy to get past, and I hit some, I guess some luck on Onix, I guess you would say, and I have the absolute perfect amount of HP to survive the bites, but the most important part is that I have enough Horn Attacks to only have to take struggle damage at the very end. Now this one was very close and very sweaty. and I survived with a mere 3 hit points left, and I know some of you are dying to know Rhyhorn's post-Brock time, and it's 59 minutes. That's 37 minutes faster than Growlithe, and that's all I'm going to say about that bad Pokemon. The next section of the game, and up to Mount Moon, isn't interesting, and Rhyhorn has an easy time. There's no TMs to pick up, and I do some extra battles just so I get some extra levels. Now this leads us to rival number 2, because the only alternative is the nightmare fight that it will be Misty. And overall, this goes pretty smooth. I get some luck to avoid sand attacks, and let me praise Rhyhorn just a little bit. While it does have some awful stats, its attack stat and defensive bulk is actually pretty good. I hit 20 in the fight, and the damage is pretty impressive. The main thing in this fight is that the one attack that Squirtle does get off, it went for a tail whip rather than a double super effective water move, and this one is one and done. I'll take it. As per usual, Nugget Bridge and the route to Bill's house is uneventful. I'm still battling some extra trainers at this point, but I pick up Dig and I decide to be stubborn, just like with Charmander, and I see if I can just save a lot of time by going ahead and just taking out Misty now. And I tried this one a lot because I feel that if I had infinite time and the right amount of luck, it could technically be possible. You can see the win condition here. I survive Staryu's attack, Dig one shots it, Misty then uses an X defend, then my Dig critically hits on the Staryu me. It sounds simple, but Rhyhorn's speed is so poor that just the Dig critical hit part of the master plan only has a roughly 5% chance of even happening. Eventually I do give up. And in this next section, I do lose a little bit of footage. I forgot to record, sorry. I pick up Body Slam on the SSN and I battle a couple of trainers. That's all you miss. Then I call an audible here. I do something I normally wouldn't do, and that's focus on the stat experience mechanic. It's known as EVs in later generation games, and it has a cap, but in generation 1 there isn't a cap. You can do every stat. The idea is the same. Certain Pokemon give you certain stats, and in this case, speed is much needed. Now without getting too mathy here, not going into a math minute with you guys, Misty Staryu has 38 speed. You can calculate that, and this means that if I can get my speed above that, I can consistently and reliably move first, one shot it with Dig, and then all I have to do is focus on maybe getting a little bit of luck with a Starmie. Maybe I'll be strong enough, but we'll have to see. But right now we're battling Diglets to get some extra speed. That's all you need to know. So that's the plan. I murder all the Diglets, and the experience isn't too bad, especially considering that there's a chance to encounter that really high level Dugtrio. It gives you a lot, but the point here is really for that speed, the extra bit of speed here. And yes, if you're thinking that this is a little time consuming, you're right. But remember that Rhyhorn has a double weakness to water and grass, and having to skip Misty means that those will essentially be the next two gyms, although we can skip Erica if we want to. I alternate slightly between battling the extra trainers inside of the SSN, and then I go back, I deplete my PP inside of Diglett Cave for a while, and then I run out of extra trainers. That means it's time for rival number 3. And with all of the extra experience I've been gaining, I'm overleveled for this fight by quite a lot. Look at how much damage Body Slam is doing, and notice that I get this very rare 5% crit. Nice. I don't heal up before the battle, and I thought it might cost me, but Rhyhorn tanks a water move from War Turtle fairly nice, to my surprise, and I end this fight by getting to level 32. I pick up Cut, I see the SSN off, and now it's time for a little more Diglett grinding. I get to the required 39 speed, and I grind just a little bit more, since speed for Rhyhorn will be useful throughout this entire run. Maxing it out will just only help us. And this leads us back to Misty, which is arguably the hardest challenge in the game for Rhyhorn, but we had a plan, and let's see how we execute it. I outspeed the Staryu since I'm a number-crunching nerd, and I knew it had 38 speed. A single Dig does knock it out. Now for the Starmie, it goes for Water Gun, it does some really heavy damage, but it doesn't crit, and I survive pretty comfortably. I then go for a Dig, Misty doesn't use an X defend, and Rhyhorn's attack stat is massive enough to one-shot the Starmie with all the extra levels, and it was satisfying to get a one-shot here, and hopefully we can make up some time and sort of coast along the rest of the game now. From there, let's skip past a boring rock tunnel visit and pick up back in Celadon. Purchasing an ice-cold Sodipop at the Pokemart gets us access to Rock Slide, and that means Rhyhorn's stock is on the rise. It's a fantastic move that offers good coverage, and it gets stab bonus on top of that. Now it's time to backtrack a little bit to face Lieutenant Surge, since we now have access to Saffron City Shortcut. And honestly, there's not a lot to say about this fight. In runs where you have to skip Misty, Surge is often a joke, Dig isn't even really needed because Body Slam does such a good job, and any threatening attacks that the Raichu may have is nullified with us being a ground type. Overall, it's barely even a speed bump in the run, and we are just cruising along. The Rocket Hideout is next, and I'm a little overleveled, so there's not much need to battle any extra trainers. That leads us to our first Giovanni fight. Super effective and stabbed digs do the trick here for the Onix and the enemy Rhyhorn, and the Kangaskhan with its normal moves don't really pose much of a threat. I get through this one relatively unscathed. It's another easy fight. Afterwards, I make a poor judgment call and I decide that I'm going to take on Erica. I do fight all of her underling trainers to get some easy experience, and then I give her a few shots. The first three attempts go exactly how you would think. The infamous 100% critical hit rate of Victory Bell's Razor Leaf against our x4 weakness to grass is as big of a mismatch as I would imagine firing a tank at a squirrel would be. It's just not pretty. Surprisingly, the fourth attempt, I get oh so close to victory. I avoid Victory Bell's attack, I take it out with a dig, I get past the Tangela, and then the Vileplume misses its initial Petal Dance. Dig just can't quite take us out, and the follow-up Petal Dance does take us out. And you'd think I'd keep bashing my head against this fight since I got really close, but I decide to move on since Victory Bell missing a move requires too much luck to just sit through this over and over. We'll come back later. For now, it's time to visit the Pokemon Tower and bully some easier opponents. It's time for rival number 4, and there's not much commentary on this one. Rock Slide and Body Slam one hits everything, and I have up to an 18 level advantage over his weakest Pokemon. This might be the easiest rival 4 fight I've ever had, and that's saying something. After finishing up and getting the Pokeflute, I head down to Fuchsia, and it's not surprising that Rhyhorn doesn't have much problems with Koga. Ground typing and access to Dig makes this an easier fight than most. I also resist Weezing self-destruct, and as you can see in the footage, it doesn't do much damage at all. After getting the badge, I do pick up the last HMs in the Safari Zone, and then I make my way towards Silphco to put our spiky little boy to the test. I do just about the minimum at first, other than picking up Earthquake for later use, and then I go ahead and I try my luck against rival number 5. I attempt this fight lots of times, and I have a pretty high success rate of making it to the end of the fight, barring the Alakazam just going off on me. The problem here, as you might have guessed, is that it's really tough to overcome the x4 water weakness. Even a measly bubble can do heavy damage, and I give this one a solid handful of times before I just concede to the fact that I'll need something else to help me out. So off to grind we go. I battle several trainers until I remember something, but we'll get back to that later. I dig out. I go ahead and I just return to face Erica really quick before I forget. Since we already got really close to beating her earlier, it's natural that having significantly more levels would make this fight really easy. Now I outspeed the Victory Bell, Dig can one-tap it, the rest of her Pokemon are nothing in comparison, and that's another gym down pretty easy. So back to earlier, what did I forget? Well friends, I forgot that Rhyhorn has water coverage in the form of Thunderbolt, and I had stashed it away in the PC earlier in the game, so I returned to Silph with our secret weapon to see how it goes, and the answer is not fucking great. If I entered the Blastoise part at full health, then maybe I'd stand a chance of getting off 2 Thunderbolts, but the Alakazam is just a menace. At minimum, it chips me down to the point to where Blastoise has an easy time, and at worst, it just takes me out itself. I clearly cannot beat this fight without more leveling. I know it's late in the video, but can I take a second to point out how god-awful Rhyhorn's back sprite is? I'm gonna go off on a tangent here while I play some of the footage of me grinding out the rest of the trainers inside of Silph. First off, it's literally just a ball with some spiky lines on it. You can barely tell what's going on with it. Who did the sprite work on some of these Generation 1 Pokemon? I demand answers. Is this really the best that you could conjure up, especially considering Rhydon was the very first Pokemon conceived and this is its pre-evolution? I know I'm being a little ranty, but it must be said. Just look at it. I have to look at this for like 10 hours between playing the game, resetting, editing, posting the video. There are a few back sprites worse than this, and that's all I'm gonna say about it. Now finally, at level 49, I return to what will probably be the toughest overall fight in the game. The first two times are very similar. I get to the execute, I get paralyzed, I lose half of my already abysmal speed, and then I get bonked by water moves to finish me off. The third attempt is the charm though. I don't one hit execute, but it doesn't go for paralysis, but instead does a leech seed. It's not ideal, but it won't hurt us for several turns since I take out the Execute the following turn, and then the Alakazam is also a one-shot. Now, I change up the strategy here just a slight bit. I use Dig on turn 1. I'm hoping that I can avoid an attack, and then maybe it'll go for Withdraw on the next turn. I Outspeed, and I hit it for very heavy damage, and then the one Leak Seed proc chips me just a little bit. Blastoise goes for a bubble, and despite it being one of the weakest moves in the game, it still does very heavy damage. I hang on, and a follow-up Thunderbolt gets me past this nightmare of a fight. And this takes us straight into Giovanni number 2. And this fight is so easy that I'm not gonna bother to even heal. 4 digs, 4 knockouts without taking any damage, and just like that, we're moving on. Since I'm here, and I have a nice physical moveset with high attack, I go ahead and I take on Sabrina. At first glance, you might not think this first attempt goes well since Kadabra opens up with a critical hit that takes off like 70% of my health, but you'd be wrong. Kadabra, Mr. Mime, and Venomoth all go down to a single attack, and then it's time for Alakazam. Turn 1, it goes for Reflect. Outside of it missing, it's the best case scenario. I go for a Dig, but the Reflect means that it can survive. Then Alakazam goes for a Side Beam, but I magically hang on with just 4 hit points, and then I finish it off with a Body Slam, and I'll take a first turn victory any day of the week. Now, after a brisk swim down to Cinnabar, we engage in a little early morning
Tombstoner, brother.
To start off the day, I do battle all of the trainers since they are high level and very easy due to Rhyhorn's typing. Now it's time to get our 7th badge from Blaine, and luckily I know the cheat code for this fight. Here it is. Rock slide, dig, dig. If you do that, you'll easily dominate this fight, and sometimes that's all there is to it. Before the final gym, I have lots of monies to spend, and I shore up my stats with some various vitamins. I save beforehand so I don't waste any, since you can't tell how many you can actually use. Eventually I get figured out. Dig has outlived its usefulness as a time skip after Blaine, and it's time for a much more superior Earthquake to fill in that gap. Heading to Viridian's gym, I also fight all of the extra trainers because I get the feeling that I'm gonna still need levels. I go into the fight at a nice level 54, and just like all the other Giovanni fights, there's not much to really talk about. Now that I got Earthquake learned, I can just slice and dice my way through his Pokemon. Dugtrio gets off a Dig since it's a speedy little mole and does a nice chunk of damage, but the rest of the fight is easy as can be. Nothing to see here as I obtain the 8th badge and we finish up the easy part of the game. Now next up is rival number 6, and I was honestly worried about this fight, but it turned out to go about as good as it could go. Pidgeot and Growlithe are non-issues, and no one really thought they would be. Execute can be annoying, and it takes 2 hits to go down, but it does go for a Solar Beam, so all it got to do really was just charge up its attack before it died. Alakazam sets up Reflect with its first turn, and then it does some minor damage with Side Beam on its next, but 2 Earthquakes move us on. Blastoise is last, and Earthquake does some solid, respectable damage. It goes for a Withdraw on its turn, and then a critical hit from the second Earthquake takes it out. I don't think the crit really mattered, but I get past this fight on the first attempt, and I'm feeling really good right now. Inside of Victory Road, I do battle a lot of optional trainers to kind of shore up my levels, and finally, that takes us to the Elite 4. Like I usually do, I do some battles at my current level just to see how it's going to go, and not very good is going to be the answer. I'm immediately met by a critical hit Aurora Beam to make me rethink my life decisions. The next attempt, I do survive a non-crit beam, but the Rock Slide just misses knocking it out, and another beam takes me out. The third attempt, I find out that Rock Slide is a range, and it could actually knock it out. I even make it past the Cloyster with a sliver of health, but Slowbro just takes me out. I'm gonna need some candies here. I use 5 of them to get to level 63, and I'll just stop there and test the waters once again. And that makes the fight much better. I outspeed and one-hit Dugong. I miss a Rock Slide against Cloyster, but it also misses. Rock Slide can one-hit it as well. Slowbro does really good damage against us, but I can two-shot it. Jinx ends up being a problem since it outspeeds, and Ice Punch does heavy damage and puts the run to a halt. I feel like I'll need to outspeed it as well, so I use several more rare candies before giving it another go. The first attempt after that, I'm reminded that Rock Slide has pretty bad accuracy, and then the fact that Clamp is absurdly broken if you're times 4 weak to it. It cuts through us like butter, like a hot knife through butter, I should say. The next 2 attempts aren't great, but I find out that I still don't outspeed Jinx, and this is gonna be a problem. I use more rare candies to see if that solves the problem, and immediately my moves decide that they don't want to work anymore, and Cloyster immediately becomes a menace by killing me with Clamp several times. I'm having a really fun time. Eventually, I make it back to Jinx, and I find out that I still don't outspeed it. I get clamped more times, and eventually, I almost have a breakthrough. I make it past the Jinx, and unfortunately, I barely fail to knock out the Lapras. It goes for, honestly, a disrespectful Hydro Pump. I mean, come on, dude. I was already really low. Why did you have to flex on me that hard? So go back at it again and again. Jinx usually ends our runs before they really get started, but eventually I do make it past the first few Pokemon without taking damage. I survive a hit from the Jinx, and I take out the Lapras in one hit. At this point, I need to make it as far as I can and keep the experience, but first let's talk about Bruno. And there's no surprises here. I don't take a single point of damage, and I basically just one hit everything. In these type of runs where maybe Lorelei or Gyarados are just raid bosses, you generally outlevel Bruno by a lot, and the fights, they happen like this. This will be the only time I show Bruno, and he's lucky I even do that. Agatha is another Elite Four member that I only show one attempt of, because we know the drill. Ground moves against her poison team is the recipe for success. I even make a lot of mistakes in the one fight I'm going to show, and I even get hit really hard just to show how easy this is. She withdraws Gengar, Earthquake misses Golbat, and then I'm just in autopilot mode just tapping A. I use another Earthquake against it by accident, but I'm still able to navigate through the fight and just take everything else out. Another time that Agatha has been really easy, and I'm glad for it. Now it's time for my first Lance fight. I outspeed Gyarados, surprisingly. I go for Thunderbolt. It's a done deal, right? Well, no, you'd be wrong. I don't knock it out, it barely survives. Then Rhyhorn gets Hydro Pumped so hard that generations of its family is going to feel the effects. On the bright side, I did get some levels, and it should make Lorelei an easier fight in the next go around. So how does Lorelei go now that we have some extra levels? Well, it starts out good, but Jinx still outspeeds us, and that's that. If I get the first part of the fight to go my way, I can overcome this fight without much issue. I show this fight again just to show some of the progress that I've made. Now, after making it past Lorelei again, I do crush the next two opponents up to Lance, and let's see how that fight goes with some extra levels. I outspeed Gyarados just like the last time, but this time, the levels are enough to take it out with a single hit. The crisis is averted. Both Dragonairs go down to a single hit, but Aerodactyl still outspeeds us. It hits us with a Supersonic to confuse us, but I do get the Rock Slide off anyway. Dragonite is last, and I hit myself a little bit, but I'm not sure it even has the moves to take us out regardless. Eventually, I do get off a Rock Slide, and I finish off the battle, and that takes us to the Champion fight. And let's see how this one played out. Pidgeot has nothing to threaten us, and a Rock Slide just takes it out just like that. Alakazam is next, and it goes for the familiar Reflect opening, but we are powerful enough to just go ahead and one hit it with Earthquake through the Reflect. Rhydon and Arcanine are the next two Pokemon, and they both have the same thing in common. They're best friends. They both get utterly destroyed by an Earthquake without doing any damage to us in return. Exeggutor is the fourth Pokemon, and I don't have a great answer for it, but thankfully it only has two normal attacking moves. Hypnosis would have been annoying, but it doesn't really get the chance to do it. I take it out, and this one has almost been too easy, right? We'll enter the Blastoise. I go for an Earthquake right off the bat to take advantage of Stab and our physical attack stat. I do a lot of damage. It then goes for a Blizzard, and I'm holding my breath, but thankfully, it does a lot, but not enough to take us out, and since we outspeed, a follow-up Thunderbolt takes the fight, and the run is over. I was fully prepared to have to keep going here, but like with Cubone, Lorelei is the big issue. It's annoying that Gyarados survived that first time, or maybe we could have just ended the run right then and there, but having access to Thunderbolt mean that we didn't have to get to something like level 90 to get past this one. So how did Rhyhorn do? Well, it finishes up with a level of 75 and a time of 6 hours and 25 minutes. It's not a great time, but I've definitely had worse. It's respectable, considering the drawbacks of the slow leveling group and a Pokemon that's weak to ice and double weak to water and grass that also doesn't naturally learn another move until level 28. So all things considered, I'm fairly happy with it. I'm gonna put it above Growlithe and Eevee, and we're gonna just put Growlithe and Eevee in their own little sucky tier spot, but above Cubone. Rhyhorn wasn't awful, but it wasn't great either. That's really all I have to say about it. I thought it was gonna be a lot worse than it actually was, but it surprised me. It has some positives to it, but we knew the negatives going in, but overall it really wasn't that bad. But I think that's gonna be about it for me. I'm working on a Psyduck video, and that should be out next week. You might notice the audio quality being a little lacking here, and that's because my mixer just shorted out on me. So I'm using a backup mic, and I think it sounds awful. I'm trying to make it work, so just kind of stick with me on that. If it sounds really bad, just let me know, and maybe I'll just stop making videos for a while until I get that sorted out. But I really didn't want to go on hiatus since it's, you know, close to the holidays. But anyway, if you enjoy this content, you know what to do. Leave a comment, interact with me, do all that kind of stuff. We'll do Psyduck next week, and it feels good to have one of these bad runs, honestly. I don't know what it is about these bad runs, but they're just fun. But all right, guys, that's about it. I'll see you on the next one. Bye.